Talk about another mental factor, which is also an unwholesome mental factor called māna. We normally translate this as a conceit. This māna is various, and there are two aspects of māna mentioned in the doctrine. I'll be covering a quite number of them. Māna is the mental state by which one compares oneself with others. So māna, with māna we compare ourselves with others. So in that sense, in the last lecture we discussed that the factor of I, idea of I, which is taken by ditti. Therefore the object of māna and ditti, when the ditti focus on I, because ditti is not always focusing on I, object of ditti can be various. But when the māna, ditti focuses upon I, and the māna starts to compare ourselves, the one's own self, the object is same I. So the different layers between, ditti comes into wrong considerations, such as the I will be transforming this from this life to another life, like a bird traveling from one tree to another, or I will get perished at the death, or I was created by a god, or some these kinds of wrong ideologies, what ditti focuses upon. The māna starts to compare myself or the I with others. I am superior to him, inferior to him, equal to him, and so forth. So mainly māna is threefold. When someone considers himself as higher to others, it's called seyamāna. When someone considers oneself to be lower than others, it is called hīnamāna. If someone considers others to be equal with others, it is called sadisamāna. So this māna is considered wrong basically in Buddhism, because the thing is, why māna is wrong? When māna arises, the person gets attached to this I and find it pleasurable and then starts to compare. So why in Buddhism it is considered as a wrong or akusala defilement, akusala state? Because from the first place there is no I to consider as so. So therefore, since there is no I, so if someone comes into the level of considering this I as higher, superior, or equal, so this is considered as a wrong type of thinking. That's why in Buddhism we consider as a wrong akusala state. Then this threefold māna, we normally say seyamāna, sadisamāna, hīnamāna, becomes threefold. So all become threefold, may basically based on the social status of a person. So this explanation, as I say now, it seems to be based on the social status of the ancient Indian or subcontinent of Indian culture. So they divided the society into three groups based on the hierarchy of the society. The persons who are considered higher are called seya. Persons who are considered very low or were called hina. Persons who are in the middle class were considered as sadisa. So here sadisa means it's referring to a middle class level. So I'll explain why do I say so. This is how the commentary explanation goes. Personally, I may explain it differently, but I will explain what the commentary says, because as I'm explaining the doctrine of the Theravādins, so it's my duty to explain what the doctrine says. But if personally, I would have a slightly a different kind of preference about this explanation. So Seya means the highest level. So according to this ancient Indian hierarchy, higher Seya was the kings, the family of the kings, or mainly the rulers, the ones who were in the top seat of the society. And also the priests, who may be the Brahmins or the ascetics who were following the spiritual pursuit. So these in a spiritual pursuit. So kings and the ascetics or the priests were considered higher in that Indian culture. Hina were the slaves who had to work for others. The thing is, in a slave's life, according to the Indian society, and also recognizing Buddhism, not encouraged, recognizing Buddhism, slave doesn't have a value or doesn't have a ownership to his own life. Slave is was considered as a person who belongs to the owner. His life belongs to the owner. It means, for example, Buddha didn't encourage this, but Buddha recognized this, and when he laid the rules to the monks, he treated the slaves different from the other beings. And also then what happened, because the social hierarchy was so therefore Buddha explained how a slave should behave towards his master, and how a master should treat his slave. So Buddha did was, because he knew that it cannot be changed, the system couldn't be changed at that time. Therefore, he explained how should the society function in order to have a proper function. So why do I say so? I'll give a slight example in the Buddhist Vinaya. For monks, stealing some other stuff is considered as a very heavy offense. It's a very heavy offense. Sometimes he may lose the monkhood because of stealing valuable things. For example, a monk steals or monks kidnaps a child of in a family, and then a monk kidnaps or steals a slave. So in these two occasions, if a monk kidnaps, for example, monks don't do it, but if it happens, the Buddha had given the rules, when he explained the disciplinary rules, he has explained in very detail to leave no doubts or leaving no further interpretations. He has explained in very detail about the Vinaya. So in a case, if the monk kidnaps a child from a family, this is not considered as stealing. Because you cannot steal. Even you take a person, kidnap a person, you are not stealing his anything. But if a monk steals a slave, this is considered as stealing. The thing was, the slave was considered as a property of the owner. So therefore, hina means belongs to these slaves. In Pali, you call it dasa. Dasa and sevaka are two things. Sevaka is a servant. Servant has his own right, he's just working for wages. But slave is a person who completely belongs to the owner in the ancient cultures. So Buddha recognized, he did never encourage this, he recognized this system. So what happened is, a higher person with a higher position in the society, when he considered himself as high, so this is the consideration, this is the way of considering, this is the social hierarchy. So the commentary says, a king considering himself to be superior than others. This is called the seyasa seyaman. It means the seyamana is the consideration himself has higher. That consideration happens to a person in a higher position of society. It's called seyasa seyamana. You can see this list from 5.13.1. From this in this list, I have given 9 possibilities. Seyasa seyo hamasmiti manu. It means the consideration of a superior as I am superior. The consideration of a superior as I am superior. Then such a person, consideration of a superior as I am equal with others. So likewise, and also consideration superior as I am inferior to others. So this seyamana comes to a superior person. For example, if you take a king. he may consider that he is superior because he is superior to all the people in the society. So this is considered as a consideration of a superior, as I am superior. Then when it comes to sadisamāna, as the commentary explains, a king compares himself with other kings and comes into idea, I am equal with other kings. Then sometimes a king may consider him with a more powerful king and then thinks that I am inferior to them. The same thing can happen with monks or monks with the pabbajitas, the ascetics. So in the same way, in such a way, so based on the sadisamāna comes to, sadisa means the people starting from the ministers, peasants like farmers and also the merchants. So these, the in between the kings and the slaves, the middle class people, when they consider about themselves as higher, as equal with others and lower to others, this is how it becomes threefold. And the slave may also consider himself superior to other slaves, equal with other slaves, or he may consider himself about himself as inferior to all the people or among the other slaves. So likewise it becomes ninefold. And also it is mentioned, if you go to the end of the paragraph 13.9, after that there's a new paragraph. Considerations mentioned under 13.1, 13.5 and 13.9. It means in this way, these three mana. Like a superior person considering himself as superior, a middle class person considering himself as equal with others, and a low caste person considering himself as low is considered as a yathava mana. Yathava mana is according to your social status. So this mana, we don't say it's a good mana. Buddhism recognizes it as a possible mana. So the other manas are considered as ayatava mana. So it goes into this level that it explains in the eradication of defilements, a putujana can have all nine types of mana. When someone becomes a sotapanna, he may not have the remaining mana. The first, these three manas are possible. So the idea is he recognizes his status in a society and he comes into a, even if he comes into a akusala mana, he comes into a proper way. It means he knows his social status. So that is why they say, the commentary says, these three manas can remain to a noble being, right? To a noble being. So then we come to the next topic, is mana again, that the 13.10, what I mentioned is because it is mentioned in the Vibhaṅgappakaraṇa. Yes.
Why the thinking of equality also is a kind of mana?
Mana means, yeah, that's a good question. Thank you. Mana. So normally we translate mana as arrogance or conceit. So it's just a translation. The actual meaning of mana is comparing. It's comparing yourself with others. So in the comparison, you may feel, someone may feel I am superior, inferior or equal. So therefore, sadisa is also considered as a mana. Okay? So mana, normally we translate mana as being proud or arrogant. So but here actually the thing is, mana is to measure. Mana comes from the root measure, man, to man.
How about if someone, his idea is not focusing on comparing, he just think we are
yeah, equal. Yeah, I'll come to that point. Not all comparison is considered as akusala in Buddhism. I'll come to that point, right? So this is considered, I'll come to that point in the next paragraph. So here mana, why the mana is, I shall read this topic, mana or comparing oneself with others is considered an unwise act in Buddhism, since there is no one to be called I in the first place. Mana considers either all the five aggregates, a few of them or one as I, and compares it with others. Others means aggregates which are considered as beings. It is said to be similar to a madness, because the thing is, since there is no I, so it's no use in comparing this person as higher, lower or superior. And this comparison is not like, so normally every person knows I have more knowledge than this person, I have less knowledge than this person, this is wisdom. We are not talking about this type of comparison. Here you are talking about someone compares it and starts to enjoy it and starts to value it with a craving. So this is considered as mana. I'll come to that point. Then atimana is the very high arrogance due to which one looks down upon others and esteems one's own self as high as a flag. In the society, normally a person with mana is recognized based on atimana. We normally call someone as arrogant or proud even he has this atimana. Then mana atimana means it happens when someone first considers oneself as equal with others and later, due to some facts, starts to consider himself to be superior to others who were considered equal before. So this mana atimana happens before someone considers him as equal with others, and then later he finds himself as superior. Then omana is the low esteem about one's own self due to the reasons such as clan, wealth, physical beauty, knowledge and skills. This is another synonym for hinamana. It's considering some self as low. Then comes adimana. It's the false consideration about one's spiritual attainments. It's also a wrong consideration. Sometimes yogis, without attaining the mundane absorption jhana and supramundane paths and fruitions lokuttara magga phala, wrongly assume themselves to have obtained these sublime spiritual feats. This wrong consideration is called adimana. So it's in the spiritual path. Without coming into jhana, some yogis believe I have attained the jhana. Without being a real noble, some people believe I have attained. So this is also a certain kind of a comparison about one's own self, one's attainments. This is also considered as a mana. Asmimāna is the consideration either all the five aggregates, a few of them, or one as I am. I will be talking about this at the end of this lesson for mana. Then the next point is, it should be noted that not all comparisons are counted as unwholesome. Comparison is necessary in some wholesome acts as well. If you go to the Salleka Sutta, Buddha mentions to Venerable Chunda, if you want to develop your spiritual qualities, one aspect is you have to consider about the level of the society. Many people are involved in killing, stealing. So they would like to do it, they appreciate it. But the wise person has to think, unlike other beings, I will not come into such low level. So then he determines to be a good person, virtuous person. So in this comparison, he finds himself others as lower, and he tries to be superior to them, better than them. So this there is a certain comparison happening there. In that is a comparison with wholesomeness. So what is the wrong comparison? I'll come to that later. Then there is another thing called samānattata. Samānattata means, this samānattata can be explained in two ways. One way is treating everyone equally. Treating everyone equally is samānattata. That I didn't explain this in this lesson. Treating everyone equally is samāna sukha dukkata means. Another one is equally means, actually it's better to say share all the happiness and sorrow with others. Like we are trying to be exchange each other's happiness and sorrows and trying to be equal. Equal means like friendly with others. So treating others equally. We can explain it as treating others equally. Then the next explanation of samānattata, as explained in the Paṭisamvidā Magga, it tells that if you go to the middle of the paragraph, samānattata has the nature of a person to compare others with oneself in terms of various aspects such as clan, social position and occupation, and treat them accordingly. Treat them accordingly. So this is not looking down or discriminating. For instance, a teacher should not treat his students in the same manner he treats his peer teachers. In the same way, it is not suitable for a monk to associate lay devotees in the same level he associates other monks. Therefore, according to Buddhist teaching, comparison is not always unwholesome. In some cases, it is an essential mental ability required to be successful in certain aspects of life. So, samānattata, this is what I find is the best explanation for samānattata. It means he compares the actual status of other people and treat accordingly. For example, take a king or a president. He cannot treat or deal with every others like he deals with other presidents or with other ministers, then the social hierarchy system will surely collapse. Therefore, samānatattā, we normally say we can give equal human rights and equal liberty for every person. So this is also samānatattā. But this equality has certain limits. So that's why when we come into certain positions, we get certain privileges. When we come into a relationship of a parent and a parents and children is quite different, because we know different beings are in different levels. So we have to treat it accordingly. For the monks, it is highly recommended that the Buddha has highly recommended and also enforced rules that the monks should keep certain distance from the lay people, lay society, and even among the monks and samaneras. So there are certain gaps that to be maintained. It's not to keep the stored social status or to secure any privileges. This is for the proper functioning of the monk society. So therefore, all the comparisons are not considered as unwholesome. Then the next question comes. How do we decide whether a comparison is unwholesome? Māna always arises with lobha. Therefore, when comparison is done with attachment towards one's own self or some aspects connected to the life, such as wealth, clan, knowledge, this sort of comparison is regarded as unwholesome. So when the unwholesome comparison happens, he starts to enjoy his superiority than the others. He starts to see that I am better than others. So there is some kind of enjoyment in it. So this is what is in Buddhism is considered as not proper. Otherwise, proper wise comparison is necessary. Without that, a human cannot live properly in the society. So that kind of a sense should be there for everyone. Then another question that comes forth is, how could attachment, we say māna is found, it happens with attachment. How could attachment is found together with hīna māna? Because it is true that with hīna māna, one looks down upon oneself. Act of looking down upon oneself mostly happens with anger. We normally, if someone looks down upon his own self, it is like he's treating himself badly, with anger. However, in some cases, it is seen that some people consider themselves inferior to others, at the same time enjoy their inferiority. This can mostly be seen in obedient servants when they talk about their masters. So sometimes there are occasions that people enjoy their inferiority and still consider them as not capable. Then according to Buddhist theory, this hīna māna, if someone has this hīna māna, it is more dangerous than this asaya māna. Because normally we see being proud in the society is considered as very very bad thing. So actually, if you go to the 13.11, atimāna, it's called atimāna. This atimāna is a quite dangerous thing, because when it comes to that level, he will not listen to others. He will only take decisions that he thinks is correct. So if it goes into that level, it's quite a dangerous kind of a mental state. But if it comes to this sayamana, normal type of sayamana, and the hinamana, considering oneself as low, according to the Buddhist literature, this hinamana is more dangerous than the sayamana. The reason is, if someone has a self-dignity, maybe it's because of mana, because of to save himself. I'm not talking about the higher arrogance or the person become really proud about himself. That is a dangerous state. But normally, sayamana, in a normal level of sayamana, it is said is more beneficial than the hina. It means I would call hinamana is more dangerous than the sayamana. That's how it is, should be said. Why? The reason is, when someone has hinamana, he always considers the negatively about himself. I cannot do it. I'm not able to do it. So these kind of negative aspects will come. But someone has sayamana, because of his mana, he doesn't want to destroy his own character. He doesn't want to bring any accusations to himself. Because of that, he will avoid himself from certain bad acts. He will also contribute himself, give his money to the charity, because otherwise people may look down upon him. So likewise, Buddhism still recognizes, even someone does things because of to protect his sayamana, Still, when he is doing the good act, it is considered as a wholesome deed. So therefore, seyamana is supportive to the wholesome acts than the hinamana. A person with hinamana is not proactive. He is not initiating any proper work. Always he thinks, I cannot do it. I will not be able to study properly. I will not be able to meditate. I may not be able to function the monk life properly. So these kinds of negative actions will come and he will not proceed in the path. Sometimes it is said, certain unwholesome deeds. It's not an encouragement for unwholesome. Certain unwholesome mental thoughts are helpful to spirituality. Buddha mentions once to Venerable Ananda, there is a certain attachment which is really conducive to the practice. That is the attachment or the craving to get liberated. And he further mentions, but Ananda, when you progress in the spiritual path, this craving in the higher level will surely hinder. So he has to abandon this at the later level. But in the initial stages, this craving is really supportive so for one's spiritual growth. So therefore, even Buddhism recognizes unwholesome states as bad and wholesome as good, black and white level. Some unwholesome states, it's considered sometimes, it's not encouraging, sometimes it's conducive. So it is also recognized. Therefore, seyamana, so I'm not talking about the real high arrogance, seyamana to a certain level is helpful for beings to do good things, but it is not an encouragement to have seyamana, because when he comes to the level of arahanthood, he gives up all these types of manas, and it is said, the Venerable Sariputta story, he recognized himself as an ox, like similar to an ox whose horns are broken. The thing is, such an ox, when he travels walks in the city, anyone can do anything to him. But he cannot do anything. He'll be just accepting all the troubles that others give, and he'll still continue his work without getting angry about others, because he knows he cannot do anything. So likewise, Sariputta, he was a very strong person, but still he considered himself like so because he didn't have any sort of mana to protect his reputation, to protect his self-status. So when it comes to that level, he is a person who would never get angry about whatever others do to him. He will not get offended because he doesn't have the self idea and he doesn't have this mana about himself. So these are the points that I want to emphasize on the mana. Then we come, I'm focusing now on the 13.15. 13.15, if I read it again, is the consideration either all the five aggregates, a few of them, or one as I am. So the idea of I. So this idea of I, in the previous lecture, we discussed that it is, in the previous lecture, we explained that this I is the object of ditti, of the self-view. At that time, the idea of I, when it comes to ditti, this I is considered as by ditti. It's not I become ditti. Ditti considers I as traveling from life to life or created by God and so forth. These kind of like philosophical considerations are there. Then, when it comes to mana, this mana compares I with others. Superior, inferior, or equal. In the same I. Then, this basic level of I, we are talking either it to be considered philosophically or either it to be compared by others. The mind has to take in the basic level the idea of I. So this idea of I, basic level of idea of I, is called asmimāna. It's called asmimāna. Asmi means, actually asmi, if you translate this as I am, the idea of I am, I do exist, there is a certain person. So this is called asmimāna. Asmimāna can be said as the basic level of the idea of I. Basic level of idea of I. The difference between the objects of māna and ditti is different. The object is same. The difference between māna and ditti is ditti considers about I in various aspects and comes into certain considerations about the existence of I. Māna compares it. That is the difference. So even without comparing, there is a certain level of māna which considers that I exist. In that māna, there is a certain appreciation about its existence. That's the point. It's not just I. Because the previous lecture I mentioned, in the wholesome deeds also, the factor of I is involved. That's why when someone is spreading loving kindness, he should first spread it to himself. May I be happy. This is not an unwholesome act. And he is spreading loving kindness to others. May he be fine. May he be happy. So these kinds of I factor is still found in wholesome deeds. Even the people like Buddha or Arahants still use this I. Because he mentioned, Buddha mentioned, I was the one who was born in such life. Then I became a Buddha. And sometimes he mentions, there is no one who is equal to me. So these considerations or sentences or sayings involve the I factor. His mind collectively cognizes his aggregates as I. But there is no appreciation in it about its existence. There is no attachment about this himself of I. So this saying of asmimāna, the difference of asmimāna and I found in other cittas is there is a certain slight attachment and appreciation, craving for this existence. This is found till one become arahant. So these wrong considerations are removed at the sotapanna. Some of the māna, I mentioned there are 9 types of māna. Out of 9, 6 are removed by the sotapanna. So these 3 considerations, why these 3 considerations can exist? Because it suits to his social status. A person truly recognizes himself, especially a noble being, and he doesn't come into wrong considerations. So therefore, these 3 manas exist till one becomes arahant. But this asmimāna is just, is no comparison going in there. At the same time, there is slight appreciation or attachment towards the existence of the I, of himself. This mana remains still the arahanthood. So these 2, these consideration, proper considerations of mana, yathava mana, is removed at the arahanthood. And this asmimāna is also removed at arahanthood. Arahanthood means becoming an arahant. Becoming an arahant. So that is the difference of this asmimāna and self-view. They are quite similar. Because why the similarity comes? When ditti considers about I, self or I, he considers about it as I. So when we say māna, the I is superior, inferior. And when it comes to asmimāna, it's just the idea of I. So therefore there is slightly different similarity between these 3 considerations. So the thing is, ditti has certain philosophical ideologies about I. I'll repeat this for the final time. Māna, the gross māna, compares it with others. And then the asmimāna, there is no comparison. It's just the appreciation or getting attached to the existence of this idea of I. So all these have to be removed if someone wants to become completely purified from all the defilements and stop the rebirth. The thing is, when we are going to be born in the next life, a person, a putujana, or even a lower noble, is going to be born in the next life. I'll be discussing this when we talk about the existence of sansara. Because there'll be a detailed explanation on how Buddhism explains, how rebirth happens without a soul. What is the mechanism explained in the doctrine? I'll be talking about the next semester. So this, for example, if I talk about this rising, the mind stream, this is one citta. I'm just drawing, the citta arises and passes away. And at the moment of death, this mind, chitta, stops at the death, final chitta happens while it passes away. Then another new chittas keep on continuing after death. This is called the process of samsara, according to Buddhist theory. There is no chitta which transforms from one life to another. It's a new chitta happening. But this chitta is related to the previous chitta of the previous life. It's a one continuation. Generation-wise, it's a one generation. But if we take different, if we differentiate each and every chitta, they have a beginning and an end. They have a beginning and end. So they are different from each other. But generation-wise, they are the same generation. So that's why in some places we mention nacha so nacha anyo. It is not a different being who is being born. Why? Generation-wise, it's the same mental stream. And it's not the same I who is born. Because no chitta or chetasika or rupa has gone from this life to the next life. There is only a causal relation of the chittas in two lives. So here, when someone is going to be born, we normally say the craving gives a support for this continuation. So what is this craving? The basic level of this craving. Craving is because of moha. So when we come to what level of craving is necessary for the continuation of this samsara, that is the appreciation of I. If even there is no comparison, rough comparison going on, even there the ditti has been removed, as long as the mind accepts or appreciates, gets attached to the existence of I, that there is a certain slight attachment. That attachment is enough. And the basic level of attachment for the samsara to continue. So therefore, this if someone wants to stop the rebirth, this attachment about existence of I, the asmimāna, has to be removed according to the Buddhist theory. So this is what I have explained. You can read the difference between asmimāna and viddhi. Some points have been explained in the paper. Then we come, as the time flows, we come to the next topic called dosa. Dosa is hatred or anger, which is not a very present chetasika, because that's why normally most of the beings doesn't like this chetasika. Actually, all of the beings doesn't like. Normally, that's why we normally say, "Don't make me angry," because this doesn't give a present feeling to us. So that's why none of us normally naturally it comes. Don't make me angry. It means we know that it will harm ourselves and also it will harm you. So to keep the balance or keep this peaceful environment, it's better to not bring this demon within us. So the anger is considered as a very dangerous thing. So how do we explain this anger according to Buddhist perspective? Dosa means the mentality that does not like the object which is being cognized. It goes against the object as if striking against it. Hence, it's called patika. It's another word for dosa is patika. So there are very nice similes given in Buddhist literature. As fire burns its dependents, firewood. Anger burns its associated mentalities, base, vattu, and the entire body in whom it arises. So we know how it affects to our body, this dosa. It arises in the mind instantly, as if some dangerous poison spreads inside the body quickly. Dosa gets very quickly, it can happen if something that we doesn't like occurs. Sometimes mind-borne matter produced by excessive level of dosa can make the body shiver. That's why when we get more angry, sometimes the body starts to shiver. Chitta rupas constantly produced by dosa for a long period can affect other three types of corporeality in the body and causes them to be less attractive. That's why when someone has dosa for a long time, his appearance starts to change. It becomes less attractive. Moreover, anger brings great harm to both one who has it and who becomes subject to its acts as an enemy who seeks for the opportunity to harm his foe. So therefore, anger is harmful not only for the one who goes under it and also the one who has it. So then, dosa has few aspects and we give various names to it according to the way it functions. So there are various aspects of dosa. The most common is kopa and koda. It means It doesn't like the object and it harms, tries to harm or go against the object. It is very, very fierce, fearful, fierce. It's not pleasant. Fierce like a serpent struck with a stick. Then it comes to bhaya. If the object is smaller than us, if the object is weaker, the person we normally goes to attack it and to take the to bring it under our complete submission. We try to dominate the object. But what happens? If the object is more powerful than us, the dosa, the same dosa happens. We don't like the object, but at that time we are not going to attack it. We are running away from it. Our mind retards from it. For example, when we are doing a class or when we are doing some important thing, a puppy comes and starts to disturb us. We would hit it and chase it away. But what do you, so we didn't like that puppy coming and disturbing us. The same way, the same place, what we do you think? An elephant comes. It disturbs us. We don't like it coming. But at that time, we are not going to chase the elephant. We are going to run away from them. So the same, the two objects, we didn't like it. If the object is weaker than us, we are going to dominate it. And we are going to hit it or treat it badly. But if the object is more stronger than us, the same quality happens. We don't like it. At that time, we run away or we go away from the object. So it is called bhaya in Buddhist literature. Then particular. Sometimes the object is really unpleasant. At that time, disgust appears in our mind. So we take away our citta mind from that object. But also we have to understand, there is a repulsive meditation. At that time, the feeling of the understanding of disgusting nature, the understanding of repulsiveness is there in the mind, but it is not affected. When it is affected, the mind gets dosa means doesn't like it and it feels very bad. So then arati, this is a dissatisfaction in any work is called arati. It arises when someone does not find pleasure in a certain work or does not get intended progress he is longing in this particular activity. Arati is another aspect of dosa. Many yogis experience this type of dosa in the initial stages of their meditation. So that's why meditation becomes not pleasant to many yogis, because arati happens in the beginning. Right? If meditation, for example, if meditation gives pleasant feeling in the beginning, everyone in the world will start to meditate. Because it doesn't give a pleasant feeling in the beginning, that's why people are reluctant to meditate. Happiness of meditation happens normally and when it progresses. In the beginning, either it becomes angry or arati for some means, and mostly it becomes upekkha. It's a neutral feeling. It doesn't give much boost to us. But when it progresses, it surely gives a pleasant feeling, so it becomes very attractive. Then appasada. Appasada means disappointing nature. This happens, we respect someone and later we find, oh, this person, this monk, this person has done very bad thing and we get disappointed about him. So normally it happens in many, countries it happens with politicians. People bring them to the seats with lots of expectations and things doesn't happen, people get disappointed. So this is also a type of dosa. When it gets excessive, they will start to blame him and start to shout him and tell all the bad things. But there is an initial stage of disappointment. So that is called appasada. Then comes this anger. If someone keeps this anger for a long time with someone, that turns into enmity. It's called vera. It's a very strong type of anger. It's very difficult to overcome. When it lasts for a long period towards the same person, it means it doesn't want to give up. That is called vera. So this same vera, considering its nature of not giving up the grudge, we call it upanaha. Upanaha is the one aspect of vera. It doesn't want to give up, so we call it upanaha. Because of the intensified nature of vera, koda, we call it vera. Then we comes to another aspect called upayasa. Upayasa is the third stage of the sarup. In the initial stage, I have marked in bold letter, it's called soka. Soka means when certain losses happen in our life, maybe a wealth, loss in wealth, loss of beloved ones, or loss of virtue, loss of his intelligence, memory. So when these things happen, people get sorrow. That is called soka. It's a very unpleasant feeling. Actually, according to Buddhist literature, soka is not dosa. So that is another aspect, like soka is sorrow. So soka is the unpleasant feeling. It's Sri Vinavali kiya domanasa vedana. But it always comes with dosa. It's connected with dosa. It's a, and no one likes, because it feels upset about its losses. Doesn't like that losing of that object. So it always comes with dosa, but in the ultimate sense, it represents the domanasa vedana. Domanasa vedana. But when this soka becomes unbearable, what happens? The person starts to cry. So soka leads to crying. We normally say, bodhana. In Pali, if I say it, cry. Crying. When crying, there happens, normally you cannot cry alone, you cannot cry silent. Crying, when crying happens, mostly there arises a certain sound. So this sound, we normally say, parideva. In Buddhist literature, parideva means like telling others, no, like telling others names, like when someone is dead. Where people say, oh, what happened to my son, what happened to my nice little boy or husband, so how I'm going to live without you. These kinds of sayings comes out. This is called parideva, right? It's called parideva. Then, when this parideva happens, normally the soka, the sorrow get reduced. So parideva is sound actually. From rodana, outcome is parideva, it's a sound. Crying also happens with dosa. So crying also happens with dosa. So dosa is always involved here. No one cries with a happy mind. Crying happens with a mind involved with dosa. It's not anger. It is not liking what has happened. So basic nature of dosa, it's not anger actually. Disliking or going against the object. That is the nature of dosa. So that's why dosa has various aspects. So mostly common is the anger. But it covers, its spectrum is quite larger. So then what happened? This soka, because of sorrow, people cry. Sometimes the sorrow reduces, ceases because of crying. But some, for some instances, it doesn't cease, it starts to remain. It's like this. It's given, the simile is given. Someone boils up water in a vessel. So when the boiling happens, this water increases. If the vessel cannot bear the amount of water, it will come out. So in the initial burning of the water is like the soro. And it increases. If it's unbearable, it comes out like tears or like words. It's called parideva. It's a very excessive level of soka. When soka reaches to higher level, it becomes parideva. Then after crying means the water coming out, then there is a limitation. After water has come out, the level will drop down and it keeps on burning inside without going out. So such a level is called upayasa. So most of the cases after crying, the sorrow will disappear. For some cases, it will keep on tormenting the person. So this is called upayasa. This upayasa is identical with dosa in the Abhidhamma perspective. It's a dosa. So when upayasa happen, people doesn't eat, eschew themselves from all the social activities and starts to look somewhere and keeps on feeling bad about what has happened. So this upayasa is very difficult to overcome. So it happens in steps, but in all the steps, dosa is involved. Dosa is involved. Then there are another quality called domanasa. Domanasa is bad feeling. This comes because the difference of soka and domanasa. Soka happens based on losses. Soka, parideva, upayasa mostly happens based on loss, losing something. Domanasa means if something happens, that if something that we don't like happens, we feel bad about it, irritated about it. So this is called domanasa. It is also connected with dosa, but in the ultimate sense, it is the domanasa vedana. And there are another two mean qualities that are connected with dosa. There are many two mean qualities, that is jealousy and stinginess. Jealousy and stinginess. Issa and Machariya. According to the list of chetasikas, which were given few the last week, I have mentioned that in the Buddhist literature, jealousy and stinginess are two separate chetasikas. I'm not going to explain them in this course, but they are always connected with dosa. Why? Jealousy means doesn't liking others' success. Stinginess means doesn't like the things that he has been used by others, or he doesn't want others to get similar things like him. A person has a car. When his neighbor is going to buy another car, he feels, oh, better, he better don't buy a car better than my one. Or he wishes that he may buy a lower priced car. So this is called stinginess, not liking others to have similar success that we as we have. This is called stinginess. Stinginess means, translation is not proper. In Pali word is called macharya. It's called macharya. So normally when you say stinginess, that he doesn't like his things to be given to others. But the macharya in the Pali literature, the range of covering is quite larger. It's not only like he doesn't like his things to be used. Things to be used means no one likes his property to be taken by others. That is a natural thing. It's a natural dosa, or sometimes we know it's not proper to be given. So that dislike is not called macharya. When it comes to macharya means, the higher macharya, for example, someone has a certain thing, he doesn't want others even to touch it, even to have a look at it, even to use it, even though it doesn't harm him, it doesn't get break, still he doesn't like anyone to use. This is called the nature of macharya. Another type of macharya means he doesn't like others to have similar success, similar luxuries that he has. Some Dhamma points, some people may know very profound Dhamma points. He may not like others to know it. This is called Dhamma macharya. Or the some information of the world, he will try to keep it for himself, not giving to others. Because if it is given, his status will be lost. Because as long as he knows it, he can be proud, or he can stand first about it. So this is called macharya. So when it comes to Buddha, always mentioned, he has nothing kept as Dhamma macharya. Whatever he knows, he always starts to try to give to others and make the others more knowledgeable. So this also happens with dosa. And the next one is kukucha. Kukucha is regret. Regret about what the evils that one has done, and about the opportunity or the good deed that one could not do. This also happens with dosa. It's a different chetasika. Kukucha means remorse or regretting about what has happened. This is another chetasika, but I'm not going to explain about it in this course. But it always happens with dosa, because he doesn't like what he did, and he doesn't like that he couldn't do good things. So this kukucha is considered as a very unwise act in Buddhist literature, because how much you repent, how much you regret, what has been done will never be corrected. And what the opportunity that was lost will never be gained. Only thing is, you have to focus not to repeat it again, and also not to lose the opportunity which will come in future. So Buddha, actually, what happens? Many people have a question. If we have done bad deeds in past, what is the remedy given by the Buddha? Actually, the remedy given by the Buddha is similar to this. It's not exactly same, similar to this. Someone hit a nail to a wood, and it was placed in a wrong manner. So what the Buddha has asked us to do, right, what Buddha has us do is, like you hit another nail from this side and remove this nail. So simile, it's just a simile. So what the Buddha has asked us to do, someone has done bad akusala, killing animals or doing stealing. So and then if someone wants to correct himself, you cannot go to the past and correct him. What you have to do is, according to Buddhist teachings, do the opposite wholesome deeds. If someone has taken the lives of others, save the lives of others. If someone has stolen the others' property, give charity to others. Make efforts to protect others' property. So likewise, you have to do the opposite things for what we have done in the unwholesome side. So that is the thing. So kukucha, or regretting about the past, will do nothing. Only thing, according to the Kamma lecture, I'll be explaining in the Kammas, if someone regrets, it's an unwholesome act, because it's always connected with dosa. We normally say in the Buddhist literature, if someone has done an act and keeps on regretting about it, this will intensify the strength of this akusala. Then there can be another misunderstanding about this. When I say it's not used to regret, it doesn't mean that the person is not supposed to have a self contemplation. Self-contemplation is a must. Buddha has explained this in suttas like Devadatta Vipatti Sutta. Because if someone has done anything wrong, he has to consider the consequences. The fault of the heaviness of his fault. So there is a certain contemplation. In Buddhist literature, we don't call it regret. Regretting in Buddhist literature means it's not the contemplation. Contemplation about your own faults is a wise act. It has to be done. If someone doesn't have this sense, he will never correct himself. So that kind of wise contemplation is a must in Buddhist practice. But what is condemned or said as not to be done is regretting about thinking the past. Oh, I did it. Why did I do it? So keep on worrying about it. It's like a slavery. Because if some people are captured on this kukucha, because personally I have met some people, it's very difficult to overcome this worrying nature. So it is never recommended in Buddhist teaching. So then I have given a list of ways the dosa can happen. According to the Anguttara Nikaya, Aghata Vattu Sutta, dosa can happen in 10 ways. Like considering about ourselves that he did harm to me, he is harming to me, or he will harm to me. There's the 3 points. Then he harmed to my beloved ones, he is harming to my beloved ones, he will harm to my beloved ones. Then he, regarding enemies, he supported my enemies, he is supporting my enemies, and he will support my enemies till the dosa can appear. Then the last one is called unnecessary dosa. This is the dosa that we mostly get. Unnecessary dosa means if the electricity goes, we get angry. If it rains too heavily, we get upset. While we are walking, our foot strikes against a rock, we get angry. So these dosa are considered in the Buddhist literature, according to the sutta, is called attana kopa. It's like getting angry for unnecessary things, right? So then we come to the unwholesome deeds done by dosa. They are like killing and harsh words, all these are wishing the cursing and wishing the other's destruction are done by dosa. And among the heinous deeds, the 5 very powerful, dangerous, heinous deeds are also done by dosa. So these are the points that I want to emphasize today. So we discussed about 2 points, the māna, lots of these details we discussed, the various of māna, the various types of māna, and also the difference of asmimāna and ditti, sakkāya ditti, and then we discussed about dosa and its sphere, range of dosa, and how many varieties of dosa are found. If you have any questions. Yes.
I want to ask about the urge to live. The urge to live. So what is the reality of Sankhya? The urge to live.
Urge, no?
The urge to be a human being.
I can't hear you. Sorry.
Urge to live.
Urge.
What do you mean by urge to live?
So what is the reality? Is it the autonoma?
It's like this. Normally, it is the lobha in the basic level. But even within the arahants, you find this certain type of urge to continue. It's a natural thing. So I would not. It's not mentioned as a lobha in that sense. It's like we can call urge when you go to the. If I further reduce this, we come into a level called chanda. Chanda is more basic than lobha. Chanda is a certain urge to do something. So when this chanda arises, when it arises together with moha, it appears as lobha. It means I'm not talking about the chanda chetasika. As you said, I'm talking about the urge, quality of urge. When this urge is connected with lobha, it appears as connected with moha, it appears as a lobha. At the same time, there is a chanda for that. So this urge gets into the attachment at the same time as the urge. So the basic level is an urge to do or some liking, something like that. Then when this urge comes with connected with qualities like sabda, which we are going to discuss next week, it becomes like a wholesome urge. So this urge is found in all the beings. For example, if you take the arahants, arahants has an urge to get into the palasamapati. They have an urge to see the Buddha sometime. They have an urge to meditate. This urge is, when you compare it with the Nibbana, is still considered as a certain kind of a desire. It's like a burning nature. In Nibbana, even such desire is not there. So, as you ask, what is this urge? I would term it as chanda. But I'm not telling about a chetasika. I'm talking about a more fundamental level. For example, another fundamental quality is called akkanti. I'm not talking about chetasikas. I'm going more further, more fundamental levels. Akkanti. Akkanti is this, not appreciating, not accepting something. So when this akkanti happens with moha, comes together with moha, it appears as dosa. When this akkanti is connected with sadda, it appears as aloba. Aloba means it doesn't let the object to come too close, for example. So likewise, these chetasikas, among these chetasikas, we can still go into very basic level. So as your question was in such a level, because the urge of a continue to live is a latent level I'm talking about. Latent level. I'm not talking about a particular chetasika. So this latent means not, I'm talking about, also not talking about specific anusaya. This is a one kind of a basic quality found in the cognition. So therefore, urge to live is something like a chanda or desire. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yes.
No, because they say that the earth to live.
Yeah.
Also,
yeah, when they will ask the parinibbana when their lifespan is going to finish.
No, they still have the lifespan continue, but the
answer. Why you say they still have the lifespan? All the stories say when they find their lifespan is going to end, that time they go and ask. I have never come across any account that arahant has started to ask for permission while their lifespan is still remaining.
In most
all the stories that I have gone and encountered is that his lifespan he finds is going to end up. Even if he asks as your question, right? There is no evidence of such a story that I have read. If he asks even if he wants to attain parinibbana, so I'm not telling this urge is not there. I'm talking about, it's not an urge that comes in the mind. I'm not talking about an urge which arises as a chetasika. It's a natural urge that remains in all the mind streams. So that is why the thing is, Sariputta said, Nabijanami jivitan, nabijanami marana. I don't accept the life and I'm not dead except the living. I'm just waiting. Like a worker who is accepting the wages at the end. So I'm accepting to attain the parinibbana. So he just let his life to continue. So what I'm saying is not about this urge, something which happens in the mind. Urge of, natural urge of all the sentient beings can even, effects of this urge can be seen in arahants. Why is that? Because it, if something is going to happen, a disaster is going to happen, arahant is not going to stand and let him die. He's going to avoid it. If he gets sick, he will treat it. So what does this mean? There is a natural urge. Urge is effected. And also even arahant has a self-consideration. Why do I say so? If we talk about the adipati pachya, aramana adipati pachya, if you have studied, we know that respecting the object, considering certain objects respectfully according to Abhidhamma. We say, when arahants respect, he respects only three objects, Nibbana, Arahata Magga, Arahata Pala, and also his own Magga Pala. Not even the Magga Pala of the Buddha. What does this mean? This is natural respect coming with the arahants towards certain objects, and it is also self-centered. Don't you take these words in a negative sense. Self-centered doesn't mean he thinks about himself, or this word is not, I'm not using this word in the normal sense it's used in the society. Even arahants cannot purely, like in the level of adipati, cannot respect the Buddha's attainment. Because why it is so important to him, this is what made him liberated. His attainment made him liberated. So therefore the idea of self, like concern about self, is still found in a person who has fully liberated. I consider these as, to my understanding, these as the very fundamental basic mental qualities which are found in every cognizing process. Right? So this is what my answer is. Yes.
Giving, the opposite is saving, you know, saving the other. However, the Musama, the Kamisumicha,
and Suram, then you should do the opposite. Okay. Right. So, mean this simile. Yeah. For Kamisumicha Chara, if someone has betrayed his partner, so this is my personal idea, right? So, it's like he should be try to be faithful to him. So, that's what I believe. Even just not break that vow again what he has taken, and also let the others to live a peaceful marriage life, encourage such things. So do encourage them not to break their vow to their partners. And if someone has lied, be truthful. That is the real advice given. Be truthful. So whatever he has done, if he has said harsh words to others to hurt them, always speak pleasant words, make them happy, and give a pleasant welcome all the time. So likewise, if someone has spoken unnecessary pisuna vacha, always try to speak a dhamma, valuable thing. Like not only dhamma, it's something which is important to the life. So these kind of changes that he has to adapt. Then what happens, I'll talk about this in the Kamma lesson very detailing, that if he develops a very powerful wholesome deed, there is an opportunity that these unwholesome deeds may not get opportunity to give results according to the Buddhist theory. So what is recommended is not to regret, always to build the opposite force.
About
crying,
like you said that kind, it depends on, because of dosa.
Yeah.
So what about, like, sometimes I have seen people, the tears comes out when they gain their victories, when they success.
Yes. But did everyone hear the question? So normally I say, I'll repeat the question. He said, crying happens in dosa citta. So Mandi is asking, sometimes we see people crying because of too much happiness, because of victory, because when a son comes home, mother feels so happy and starts to cry. So I'm not telling that even in, for example, if a mother starts to cry seeing his son for a long time, I am saying the beginning she is happy, but the second cry is because of sorrow, that's for sure. Right? That's why she feels like, she feels sad, why she missed him and so forth. But there is a certain moment, because of excessive happiness, these tears come out. Tears coming out and crying is not the same thing, it's two things. When I say crying, it is something that happens with an unpleasant feeling. Tears coming out, the very obvious incident is too much smiling, laughing. Right? There are six types of laughs. One laugh is, some people laugh till the tears come out. They cannot control their happiness, they cannot control their joy. So at that time, tears come out. So therefore, as you said, there are two ways the tears can come out, because of excessive happiness and because of Domanasa. So here I was referring only to that. Okay, so we'll then, if you have no question, we'll conclude and we'll meet on the next Sunday.